Think of what you're doing. You might take 2 to 3 glasses of red wine each day to help heart disease, but what else is happening? What else is happening in your body with that alcohol? I've thought about this a great deal. Why is it red wine? Why not white wine? Why not white wine? Why doesn't the alcohol help you with white wine or vodka? It's red wine. Why? It's not the alcohol, Mark. It's not the alcohol at all. They've actually shown that non-alcoholic red wine carries the same benefit without the risks. For that matter, I mean, the benefit is flavonoids, isn't it? It's antioxidants. You can get the same benefit from exercise and fresh vegetables without the risk of alcohol, without all the negative things that come with drinking.
You know, Sean, I think we need to factor some things in about the French study, too, and there are 3 or 4 things that come to my mind. Number one, heart disease is the number 2 killer in France. So it's not accurate to say that the French have no heart disease because they drink wine. It's just not factual. Number 2, the French, out of a study of 24 nations, in these 24 nations, alcohol consumption from 1950 to 1980 went up 70%. In the French, it went down 15%. Why? Because the French realized the social consequences of drinking. Now, here's an interesting fact about the French study. If you take the amount of milk that the French drink and you compare that with other nations that drink approximately the same amount of milk, the French drink very low amounts of milk. If you take the amount of milk they drink in dairy and you compare that with other nations, they have about the same heart attack rates as other nations who drink that amount of milk or take that amount of dairy. So it may not be the wine issue at all. Now, the other issue is that the French eat a lot of fruits and vegetables, which increases your antioxidants. Here's another thing to take in consideration. Let's compare the French that drink a little bit of wine with Seventh-day Adventists who don't drink any wine.
Okay.
The heart attack rates of Seventh-day Adventists who don't drink any wine are dramatically less than the French who drink a little wine.
So you don't need the wine.
That's the whole point.
You just don't need the wine.
It's not factual to think that you need wine to reduce coronary heart disease. A good diet, a good exercise, and the problem is the wine may have some benefits, but it has all these liabilities which are significant.
Absolutely. You might have a healthy heart, but you might beat your wife because you can't control what you've been drinking.
Sure. You know, but some people say that alcoholism is genetic. Is it genetic?
Well, let's suppose for a moment that it is. Let's say that we do know that we inherit tendencies from our parents. And let's say my parents wrestled with alcohol, which they don't. But let's say that they did, and then I developed that same problem. Does that mean that I am now condemned? I have absolutely no choice? Are my genes steering me in a direction which I cannot control? I refuse to be that fatalistic. I don't think the Bible goes that direction. I might have irresistible urges, but that doesn't mean there's no way out. 1 Corinthians chapter 10. 1 Corinthians chapter 10 and verse 13 tells us a little bit about any problem, but I think this applies to alcohol as well. It says in 1 Corinthians 10 verse 13, "There has no temptation taken you but such as is common to man." No temptation, including alcohol. "But God is faithful, who will not suffer you to be tempted above that you are able, but will with the temptation also make a way to escape that you may be able to bear it." No temptation. Nothing you are tempted with doesn't have a solution from God. Even if you have irresistible urges, He's bigger than those urges. He'll give you a way out.
You know, there are many genetic trends that are outlined in Scripture. A person may have a genetic trend to lose their temper, for example. They may have a genetic trend for anger. A person born of a crack addict may have a genetic predisposition for crack. A person born of an alcoholic father may have a predisposition to alcohol. Whether the predisposition is for lust, whether it's for anger, whether it's for impatience, we all have fallen natures, and we all have a predisposition towards something. So
That's
in
right.
a sense, we're all in the same boat with the alcoholic because we're all sinners.
That's
but
right.
because we have that genetic predisposition does not mitigate against in any way the grace of God coming and giving us strength as you've so adequately presented today, Sean. It's God's grace. It's God's mercy. It's
That's
God's
right.
power.
He's bigger than the bottle.
Exactly. Talk to the person for a few moments, Sean, who is really struggling with a issue with alcoholism in their mind. And talk to that college student as well who is fiddling around socially drinking to be acceptable in their dorm room.
Sure. You know, if you're wrestling with alcohol, I think a lot of people in their heart are sensing that they have a problem right now at this moment, that this is out of control, out of their hands. And you need to understand, you don't have to go through this alone, first of all. One of the reasons Christ established a church is so that we don't have to face struggles alone. So go, start talking to somebody, come to a church, talk to a pastor, be honest, recognize that problem, confess it to God, and then 1 Corinthians 15:57 says, thanks be to God who gives us victory. Mm-hmm. You don't have to struggle for something that's a gift, do you? God will hand it to you. Get that help. God can hand that to you. But talk to somebody. Find a Christian you can pray with. Go to a pastor. Talk to them. You can be free from this. And I don't mean struggling with it the rest of your life. You can be absolutely free.
Jesus offers us something better than a binge. In John chapter 4, Jesus met a woman with incredibly low self-esteem. She was the object of scorn and ridicule in Samaria. Everyone knew her, and the men of the village knew her only too well. She had an intense longing for love. This unfulfilled longing led her to sell her body to the highest bidder. She prostituted herself. She sold out cheap. She destroyed herself on the altar of passion. Jesus offered her more, much more than she could ever imagine, speaking of her insatiable search for satisfaction in all the wrong places. Jesus said in John chapter 4 and verse 14, "But whoever drinks of the water that I shall give him will never thirst. But the water that I shall give him will become in him a fountain of water springing up into everlasting life." Like the woman at the well, the drinker has an insatiable desire, which can never be quenched. The more they drink, the more they desire. One drink demands the next, and the next, and the next. Jesus offers us something so much better. The water of life, his own loving presence fully satisfies. Jesus Christ offers us himself. He is better than a binge. Drinking at the fountain of his love, we are fulfilled. Drinking in his grace, we are satisfied. Drinking from the living stream of his goodness, we are content. So come. Come to the waters of his love, his grace, his mercy, his goodness, his compassion, his forgiveness, his acceptance, his power. Come. Come to this Christ who can meet the need of the human heart. Do you feel burdened today? Is there something that's really troubling you? Something that's really bothering you? You need not lose yourself in a drink, only to wake up in the morning with the same thing troubling you, the same thing bothering you, the same thing burdening you. You can find in Jesus the center of your life. You can find in Jesus the purpose of living. You can find in Jesus the one that will fill the aching void within. Would you like to say right now as Sean prays, "Jesus, I want you to be the center of my life."
Our gracious Father in heaven, today somebody watching this program has been turning to things to solve life's problem that leave them feeling empty. They sense chains on them. They sense that they are slaves to substances. And today, they want to be free. Teach us, Lord, to look to Jesus Christ. He has taken everything that sets us back and nailed it to the cross. Teach us to take him by the hand as he leads us into a better, more abundant life. Teach us, Lord, to drink from the streams of living water. Touch that person today. Help them to sense how close you are, how much you love them, and to know that you will set them free. For we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.